HTTP headers. What are they? How can I use them? What are HTTP headers? HTTP headers let the client and server pass additional information with an HTTP request or response. It is defined as first having a case-insensitive name, followed by a colon, followed by a value. So where do headers fit in? So here's the example we've seen before about requests and responses. Now, the headers are actually the ones denoted in red, so they're all over the place and fundamental to the way HTTP works. Headers can be grouped according to their contexts. There's general headers, which are additional information about the request and response, request headers, which are about the request, response headers, which are about the response, and entity headers, which contain information about the body of a resource. So general headers are HTTP headers that can be used for both requests and responses, but they don't apply to the content itself. Meanwhile, request headers are used in HTTP requests, but don't relate to the content of the message. Similarly, response headers are used in an HTTP response, and again don't relate to the content. What does relate to the content of the message are entity headers, which are used to describe the content of the message, such as the length of the message. So what are the different categories of HTTP headers? Well, there's a lot, and I'm going to be going through some of the fundamentals today. So for authentication, there's www-authentication. This is what the server defines as the authentication method used to access a resource. This is then sent to the client, and the client sends back authorization header, which actually contains the credentials to authenticate the user agent with the server. Caching is another major topic we discussed before, where the user can specify the age, which is time and seconds, that an object has been in proxy cache. It specifies these with the help of cache control, which is the actual mechanism used, as I described in a previous video. Then, expires would actually say the date and time after which the response is considered stale, so that would be provided by the server to the client. Conditional. So here we have last modified, which is the last modification date of the resource. Then we have the ETag header, which is a unique string identifying the version of the resource. This unique string can be thought of as a longitudinal hash based on the contents and the version of the resource. Then we have ifMatch, which makes the request conditional on matching one of the ETags. In contrast, we have ifNonMatch, which makes the request conditional on that it doesn't match any of the provided ETags. Then we have ifModifiedSince, so it makes the request conditional on the basis that the resource has been modified since. Similarly, and also in contrast, if unmodified since, then it makes the request only if it has not been modified since. So this is used for concepts such as optimistic concurrency control algorithms. Then we have connection management, which I talked about also in a previous video. HTTP 1.1 makes keep alive connections possible, so you can use the same TCP connection for sending more content. Again, you can specify this using connection keep alive, and keep alive specifies property of the persistent connection. Then we have content negotiation, which again, this can specify the char set, encoding, and then the language that is accepted by the server. We also have the concept of cookies. Cookies are sent using HTTP headers. You can use setCookie to actually set what cookies you want to send from the server to the user agent, and then the cookie header will contain the stored cookies. We also have, for entity type, we also have the message body information, which includes content length, the type, the language, and then the location. Lastly, we also have redirects. For example, we have the location, which was used in HTTP 308. This will indicate the URL to redirect the page to. We also have the request context, which specifies information about the client, such as the host name used for virtual servers, or the from, which can include the email address. Similarly, we have the response context, which is different HTTP versions that are allowed, so you don't get a HTTP 405, or the server, which indicates data about the server that accepts the request. Lastly, we have others. For example, we have date. Fun fact about date is that only the GMT time zone is actually supported by date, so you need to be careful when specifying date. And lastly, source map, which is commonly used for debugging JavaScript. There's also a major concept called CORS, which is cross-origin resource sharing. That'll be reviewed in a later video. It's time for some review. Question 1. What are the four groupings of HTTP headers? 3, 2, 1. General headers, request, response, and entity headers. In caching, what is the difference between the age header and expires? 3, 2, 1. Age header expresses the time and seconds that the object has been in proxy cache. In contrast, expires is the date and time after which the response is considered stale. What is an ETag, and there's two conditional headers used with ETags? 3, 2, 1. ETags are unique strings identifying the version of the resource. So we have ifMatch and ifNonMatch. Are you allowed to use any time zone for the date header? Just said this. 3, 2, 1. No. HTTP dates are always expressed in GMT time, never local time. Thank you very much for watching, I hope you enjoyed this video.